My talk is just an introduction on what my specialty is. So what oculoplasty is. Now, I get this question very often, as in what oculoplasty is. 25 years ago, one ophthalmologist used to treat every disease of the eye. Now, as you can see, there are 5 ophthalmologists treating one eye. Soon there will be so much specialization, you will have a right eye specialist and a left eye specialist. But till then, our level of specialty is such that we have demarcated our areas. And oculoplasty basically is, in a nutshell, the art and science of beautiful eyes. It includes everything related to the eyelids, tumors of the eye, lacrimal disorders, trauma, the orbit, the bony socket, and cosmetic procedures like Botox, fillers, and facial aesthetic surgery. So I'm just going to touch over each of these and show you photographs, clinical cases of patients whom we see. So when we talk about eyelid diseases, the most common that we encounter is ptosis. And ptosis is basically drooping of any one eye or both eyes. So this is the most commonest thing. We almost encounter this at least 4 or 5 patients every week. Now this is something that can be corrected very well, easily, without a scar, such that they retain the height and the contour of the normal eye. Now you can see here the right eye has been, the left eye here has been operated, and you can barely appreciate a scar. Similar is the case in the right eye of this young lady. Now sometimes it's very important in children to identify and operate this early, because children, if they don't get operated early, the ptosis, the drooping, covers the eye completely and that eye becomes amblyopic, or it becomes a lazy eye, and that's very important. Some unusual things that we see is sometimes there is a associated jaw winking phenomenon with ptosis. Then another common thing that we see congenitally is entropion, where you can see the lashes of this baby are completely turned inward and they are rubbing on the eye. Again, surgically they can be corrected with minimal scarring. Similarly, in the older age group, we have senile entropion, where the eyelashes are rubbing the eye because the eyelid turns inwards. This also can be corrected surgically to give good results. Now, lacrimal disorders is associated with watering of the eye. Now, this is basically can be seen congenitally. That is the most common thing. We have children, babies less than 1 year of age, whose eyes are watering. We commonly ask them to, you know, massage over the eyelids, over the lacrimal sac, to relieve that. But any obstruction at any level in the entire drainage system can cause watering that needs to be corrected surgically. And if left untreated, they can develop a big abscess or a acute dacryocystitis like this, which then needs to be treated initially with antibiotics and subsequently with surgery to reduce that. Now, another less known aspect about oculoplastics is ocular oncology. Now, you'd ask me that how common are tumors of the eye? Well, they are pretty common, and when we talk about ocular oncology, we're talking about everything, not just tumors within the eye, but the eyelid, the conjunctiva, the surface, intraocular tumors, as well as tumors within the orbit or orbital tumors. So intraocular tumors, of course, are less amenable to be treated in a private setting. We need an institute where we can treat them, or a big hospital, because they need a multimodal treatment of radiation, chemotherapy. But just so that we are aware that retinoblastoma is very common, and the most common way we pick it up is by seeing the yellow reflex in the eye when we click a photograph with a flash, and you know, or unexplained squint, unexplained bleeding within the eye, or if there is a family history of one sibling who has it. Similarly, in adults, uveal melanoma is a common intraocular tumor. Other surface tumors that we can pick up commonly is people complain with a white dot or a red dot in the eye. And most commonly, they are very benign, but they can be squamous cell carcinomas like these. These are all different variants of ocular surface squamous cell carcinoma, particularly seen in the immunocompromised patients who are HIV positive, because the HPV virus also has a predilection to cause squamous cell carcinoma of the conjunctiva. Apart from ocular cell squamous carcinoma, even melanocytic or pigmented tumors can occur in the conjunctiva. And there's a whole big variety of them. They can be primary acquired melanosis, nevus, epithelioid nevus and melanomas, melanocytosis, each of them are different conditions. And each of them need to be identified and treated. So it's not just one simple conjunctival tumors can be quite complex with a variety of presentations. Sometimes something as minor as a trauma in the eyelid, if not attended to, can develop into what is called a pyogenic granuloma, which can otherwise look quite worrisome, but can be treated very well without leaving any scar behind. Now similarly, when we come from the conjunctival surface to the eyelid, especially in the older age group, there are a lot of eyelid tumors that are seen, like basal cell carcinomas, which can be locally aggressive. They don't metastasize to different parts of the body, but they can burrow in and affect the bone, affecting different sites. The canthus, that is at the angle of the eye, the tumors affecting the angle of the eye have a high predilection for intracranial extension. So you should be very aware of picking these tumors up. Eyelid tumors can be excised and the eyelid can be reconstructed. Pigmented tumors, again, melanomas have a high rate of metastatic spread. So we should be a little careful with these. Then coming to tumors behind the eye, that is within the orbit. Now they can be proptosis or outward protrusion of the eye is the most common way these patients will present. Now this lady, of course, is an extreme case who presented after 6 years of gradual progression of the protrusion of the eye. But with a minimally invasive technique using the eyelid crease, we are able to treat, and her vision, of course, she regained all her lost vision because of the compressive effect. But the joy comes in treating these patients who are happy even with the cosmesis after such a big tumor excision. Similarly, in children, they can, these are congenital tumors that develop at the angle of the eyebrow. These are called dermoid tumors. Here you can see it in the CT scan. Again, without a scar, we can excise them. So the way we make sure that there is no scar is we utilize the eyelid crease to make the incision, and using a tunneling technique, we can go up and excise that tumor. Now sometimes we get these rare cases of where we see unusual clinical signs. So I just thought, since my talk is post lunch, I'll have a little unusual video to awaken all of us. So this was a gentleman who said very unique symptoms, that whenever I bend down, my eye seems to come out. And we all wondering, how does that happen? He said, no, whenever I bend down or whenever I'm straining, suppose I'm going to the toilet, I feel that my eye is coming out. Now we've always read in textbooks that positional proptosis can occur in a condition called orbital varices, but very rarely do we actually end up seeing these patients. So these are vessels within the orbit, varices, like we have varicose veins, dilated veins of the orbit. They get accumulated, the blood gets stagnated within it. And when we are straining or there is increase in intra-abdominal pressure, these veins get engorged. So this is how he looks when he is normal. And when you see him straining, this is how it becomes. So it's the dramatic effect of this was what I was looking at. So of course, these patients also can be treated with surgery. We first inject intralesional sclerosants to sclerose the varices, and then we can go and operate them. The other part of my specialty is also ocular trauma. Now again, trauma doesn't just mean the eye. It can mean the eyelid, the bony socket around the eye, like this gentleman who came with a trauma that was almost 1 week old. Now what is important is that the canaliculus or the lacrimal drainage, the tear duct, is cut in this patient. So in these patients, we have to go and reconstruct the tear duct such that the patient doesn't end up getting watering after the surgery. And again, we get some extreme cases of trauma. This gentleman who came walking to our clinic with a piece of wood sticking out of his eye. So we were pretty convinced that this eye is completely lost. So we ended up doing a CT scan, and then we could visualize that the eye was actually hidden somewhere within the bony socket. And this wooden piece had pierced the orbit and was lying in very close proximity with the frontal lobe, but thankfully not the brain. We went ahead and removed the piece, and gradually over time, the patient recovered substantially to gain nearly half of the vision in that eye. So this is the pre-op and on the left side, and that's how he became post-surgery. So very gratifying for both the doctors and the patients. Another common cause that of trauma in around the eyelid that we see is perioocular dog bites. Now, very common. Now, one word of caution is that we've all read, we all know that dog bite wounds are not to be sutured. The WHO guidelines do mention one exception, and that is the eyelid. Because if the eyelid is not sutured, it can lead to exposure keratopathy and loss of vision. And that is something that should not happen. So, despite conventional wisdom that no dog bite wound should be sutured, the eyelid has to be sutured, because if this pedicle were to be left alone, it would eventually get necrosed at the edge, and loss of tissue of the eyelid makes it very difficult to reconstruct it. And with all prophylactic of local injection of anti-venom, anti-sera, immunoglobulin sera, and Rabipur to be the schedule to continue, we can reconstruct the eyelid with very gratifying results. We can barely tell that he had a dog bite. Similarly, a lot of domestic violence and road traffic accident. This lady was attacked by her husband with an axe in a fit of rage. Over time, we have been able to reconstruct, and she now has some semblance of an eyelid back. A lot of patients require socket reconstruction and globe reconstruction. So these are patients who had trauma, you know, when they were a child, and the eye completely shrivels up and becomes a small thing like this. Now, the eye doesn't have any vision, but what we can do is give them cosmetic rehabilitation with the help of a prosthetic eye. And today, the prosthetic eye, the technology that we have of recreating prosthetic eye is so advanced that we are able to actually recreate even the blood vessels that are appearing on the eye. And at the end of the prosthetic sitting, you won't be able to tell which eye was the affected eye and which eye is the normal eye. Similarly, this lady also had a trauma when she was a child, and we are able to do it. So what we do is, it involves a surgery where we remove the eye, the deformed eye, place an orbital implant within the eye such that the volume is restored, and on top of this implant is where we place the prosthetic shell. Now, coming to the orbit, like we mentioned, the bony socket, the most commonest thing that we see affecting the orbit is Graves' disease or exophthalmos, proptosis. So patients come with, in some patients they come with just a lot of soft tissue swelling around the eye, and when we do imaging, we can see that the extraocular muscles are enlarged. You can see from this angle that the eyes are definitely proptosed before surgery. This is after surgery, when we have taken care of the eyelid bags and also pushed the globe back in. The way we do it is much like how you would try to fit a scoop of ice cream into a cone. So the size of the ice cream scoop will not change, because that is the eye. What we can do is widen the cone so that the eye goes back into the socket. This is the classical Graves ophthalmopathy look, with the surprise staring look because of lid retraction and soft tissue enlargement. With a three-wall decompression, we can actually give them very good results, such that the globe sits back into the orbit. Sometimes the eye doesn't come out, just the eyelid gets retracted. Like in this case, it can even be unilateral or bilateral. Like in these ladies, both of these cases had unilateral retraction of the eyelid. It becomes very embarrassing socially, and a lot of times they don't even seek treatment for it. But as a clinician, we can pick it up and advise them to get their thyroid function test done, and so on and so forth. Now, coming to Botox. Now, whenever I say Botox, everybody thinks of cosmetic uses. Well, Botox actually has more functional use than cosmetic uses. So a lot of cases of blepharospasm and hemifacial tics and spasms can be treated very effectively with Botox. The only catch is that the duration of action of Botox lasts only for 4 to 5 months. So every 4 to 5 months, they would need to get injected. We have patients who have been treated with Botox for almost 12 years now. Very religiously, they come every 4 months, get it done. So on a long-term basis, Botox for spasms can be treated. These are patients who have bilateral hemifacial spasms, bilateral blepharospasms, unable to keep their eyes open. And it can be extremely difficult for a patient with blepharospasm to even walk, because their eyes are involuntarily shut. With Botox, that completely releases the protractor muscles of the eyelid, and they are able to keep their eyes open and have mobility as well as vision. So earlier you could see, to keep his eyes open, they would have to manually lift their eyelid. And finally, facial aesthetics. We just try to stick to the eyelid. The most common thing that I hear is then, why can't I send it to a plastic surgeon? Well, because the eyelid has a unique anatomy, and this is something that we've been trained to do. And the eyelid is the only part of the face, the eye, that we treat. So a specialist can always do a better job than a man who also does all other parts of the body. So for the upper lid, we have a lot of patients who have a lot of overhanging skin. Now this can be in younger patients also who have this condition called blepharocalasis, where they have recurrent episodes of swelling of the upper eyelid, which is associated with this boggy skin that gets collected. Now that can be corrected and they can have a very normal contour of the eyelid. This is in the younger age group, whereas in the older age group, because of age-related change and gravity, the excess skin around the eyelids can make a fold, and this can overhang and droop on the sides. Now this also can be corrected very well, and like we saw in the patients with ptosis, there is no resulting scar. So it just gives you a very youthful look. And it's not just that old people need this. Now a lot of younger people with their lifestyles of all the different changes that they do, irregular sleep habits, they tend to get, and also thyroid eye disease. So this puffiness is something that younger people are very conscious about. So, you know, eyelid bags that develop, not just the young people, but also older people. So this is a transconjunctival blepharoplasty, different from what the plastic surgeon would do. A plastic surgeon would prefer to do a transcutaneous blepharoplasty, where a scar would be made on the skin and this excess bag of fat would be excised. Now what an oculoplastic surgeon can offer is, because in being an ophthalmologist, they can go through the conjunctiva on the inner side. The net effect is the correction is equally good, but there is no scar. So, and when you're treating a patient who has cosmetic concerns, the last thing you want to give them is a scar. And it's not always surgery. Sometimes these things can also be masked very well with what is now called dermal fillers. These are hyaluronic acid gel injections, the same thing that the same material present in our joints. So she had a concern that these eyelid bags and this crease was very prominent. Now this is called the nasolabial fold, the tear trough deformity, and with that injection of filler, we can smoothen that. It's like placing cement between two tiles. So you just smoothen that so that it becomes seamless, and the effect is that shadow goes away. It can also be done in slightly younger person. Now she had dark circles, darker skin like Indians with dark circles. Fillers can do a fantastic job and mask that completely. So all in all, this is the overview of my branches. So there's more to ophthalmology than just cataract, and oculoplasty is a very specialized branch. So a lot of it depends on the clinical acumen, because many patients are themselves not aware of the conditions that they have, which is why the onus on the referring practitioner is very high, to have a high degree of suspicion. And as you can see, it can give us very satisfying results for the doctor, the patient, and everybody around. Thank you. I think, are there any questions? Yes, so we do brow lifts that can be done endoscopically. So we make a coronal incision, 3 incisions here. Using an endoscope, we lift the periosteums to give that look. The facelift can be done again through a pre-oral incision here. In men, especially Indian males, the scar may be visible, but in women, the scar can be hidden very well to give a good correction. But then again, facelifts tend to have a lifespan of shelf life around 8 to 9 years. Beyond which it comes back to where it was, because you can't beat gravity, so that pulls it down anyways. Yeah. Like we said, there are 2 parts to the whole surgery that we do. So one is the surgery where we remove the eye and place an implant. And we have to give a waiting period of at least 6 weeks between the healing of the conjunctival wound and placing and preparing the prosthesis. So roughly the surgery itself would cost somewhere between 30,000 to 35,000, and about half that amount, so around 17,000 to 20,000, for the prosthesis. So I think the entire thing would not be more than 60,000 for a patient. Mind you, the people who make the prostheses are specialists. They are optometrists who are called ocularists, whose only job is to make these prostheses. So that they work in conjunction with oculoplasty surgeons. Yes, ma'am.
Iris of two different colors into both the eyes.
Right, ma'am.
So what do you have for that?
So as long as the vision can is
no, forget the vision, the cosmetic.
So there are colored contact lenses that can be offered.
That's it?
That's the only
That's
thing.
It?
Well, there are a couple of people who do who actually do the, I don't know, I think Mitesh might have an idea. There is iris recoloring surgery, but I'm a little skeptical about that. But from a functional point of view, if vision is normal, I would not be too keen on pressing for a surgery.
No, no, vision is not there at all.
Vision is not there?
Only perception of light.
So then in that case, colored contact lenses can do well. Or else if they want absolute identical color, this surgery could be advised. Because this is mainly for non-seeing eyes, where we can then recreate. So, yeah, we have good iris colored contact.
As you said, if it's a perception of light, the best thing to go for is simplest, cheapest, and best.
Colored contact.